This is a production of Cornell University.
Well, I want to thank Adrian for a very generous introduction, probably over-generous, and I want to thank you for coming to hear this talk, which may never be given. Okay, so I chose modeling as a topic for my presentation because it appears to be particularly relevant and very timely. Well, I can share a little bit of personal history. I was looking up in my diary, actually in my journal, and I found out that within 2 days in 1978, I actually gave my entrance seminar to the department in this room. So the choice of date seems particularly apropos. The difference, of course, was that the seating arrangement was completely reversed. The screen was in the back, all the chairs faced that way. And instead of having a computer with PowerPoints that don't work, there was a 2x2 slide projector.
Which did work,
yes. So a botanist, a zoologist, and a mycologist walk into a bar. Okay, I'm not going to touch anything. I'm just going to touch the clicker, okay? Okay. Now, I'm actually going to turn off the lights because I'm a morphologist and I'm used to working in the dark. Okay, so the reason I picked the topic is because it appears that modeling has taken a new high road recently. This is actually a quote from a 2016 NSF report talking about the importance of biological modeling and the fear that it might actually fall between the cracks of funding agencies. So certainly NSF and a number of other funding agencies have taken note that biological modeling is important, and no higher authority than Wikipedia actually has an entrance talking about biological modeling and the systems to a variety of biological disciplines. So I think talking about modeling in general is particularly interesting and relevant. But I will tell you, when I was a graduate student and I started doing my first modeling, it was actually frowned upon. It was thought to be mostly, you know, smoke and mirrors. Most people really didn't trust mathematics, or at least not mathematics applied to biological systems. The only point of entry in the old days was really in ecology, where a lot of ecological modeling had become fashionable. So what am I talking about when I actually am using the word modeling? So I went to Webster's Dictionary and, of course, looked up the various definitions for model. You know, representation of a person, a thing, or a phenomenon, or a system that can be used as an example. So a model person, a model system. Me, maybe. Arabidopsis, most certainly. But the kind of definition that I want to use is a material, visual, mathematical, or computational analog used to construct a theory. Now notice, to construct a theory, and notice the entrance says, see also hypothesis or theory. And that's what I mean by modeling, at least in the context of my talk. Now, what drew me to look into modeling is that ever since I started studying biological systems, I've always really been fascinated by the relationship between organic structure and function. And I've been interested in that for a very long time, even actually as an undergraduate major in mathematics, because you can't help but look at a plant or an animal and think about its structure and its function that could be quantified using the tools of math and physics. There's another dimension, however, and that is my background in PhD thesis had to do with evolution. And so the other axis in this interest is how the environment influences the interplay between organic structure and function, and the historical aspects that have led up to the structure-function relationship. So this actually is an interplay of at least four very important components that converge on our understanding of what a plant, a fungus, or even a bacterium is. So when you start looking at the application of the physical sciences towards biology. Being a physical scientist, it's actually comparatively easy. I made a little list here, if you're an engineer or a physicist, of what you have to look forward to. If you're designing a structure, a mechanism of some sort, you know where that mechanism is going to function. The workplace is already specified for you. And the design specifications are specified for you. How big is the machine? How big is the structure that you're doing? And the function of that structure is already specified a priori. So an engineer is given a task. Here is where you're going to build something. This is what it has to do. And you have the materials and the materials that are going to be used to fabricate it. And if they don't work, you can choose a different material, aluminum instead of iron, et cetera, et cetera. And finally, with very few exceptions, engineered artifacts have a single function. And that means that you can design a structure to actually maximize the performance of that function. Also in physics, not in engineering, but certainly in engineering, one accurate and precise measurement can actually suffice. Now, biomechanics and biophysics. Well, here is where we get into a little bit of trouble. The environment is variable, the organism has to be examined, and its functions have to be inferred. We have to guess what something is doing. Yes, a wing, a fin, we can pretty much be sure that our guess is correct. But there are many things, like, for example, the prickles on a rose, these downward, nasty-looking things. What are they really doing? Are they grappling hooks? Are they deterrents of herbivores? Are they doing both? The other thing is that an organism's materials and structure are the result of its evolutionary legacy. It didn't get there de novo. It went through a whole sequence of events. And finally, at least in terms of biomechanics, most organic structures have multiple functions, not just single ones. So you can't maximize the performance of the function. You actually have to compromise and optimize. And finally, in biophysics, multiple measurements are required, unlike physics. I often tell my students, some of whom are here, and I'm not sure I've told them this, if you measure an electron accurately, you know the mass of an electron throughout the universe. If you measure a gerbil, you happen to know the weight of that gerbil on that day at that time, okay? So we have many challenges, not the least of which is that many biological models appear overly simplistic because of the multitude of functions that organisms, even a single cell, has to perform. I mean, the classic example there is assume a spherical cow existing in a vacuum. You know, this is what a lot of us sometimes do. Imagine a spherical plant existing in a vacuum. Well, I can imagine it, but I'm never going to find one, I suppose. The thing is that things have certainly been improved, and that is our modeling techniques are a lot more sophisticated with the rise of computational sophistication. Computers now can handle data sets that in my day nobody would ever accumulate because they knew they couldn't do a single linear regression on it, because in my day you had to do it by hand. The other problem that we face is that models can give the correct answers for the wrong reason. I'm giving you an example here of Ptolemy's astrolabe, this little device shown over here. Completely accurate. It could predict the motion of the planets, the known planets in those days. It could predict solar and lunar eclipses with perfect fidelity to reality. There's only one little problem. It was a geocentric device. It assumes that the Earth was in the center of the solar system. So it gave you the right answers, but from a mechanistic understanding of the solar system, it was totally wrong. Okay, so with all of these caveats in mind, I'd like to give you a few examples of the kind of modeling that I did starting way back when most of you, at least the younger ones, weren't even born. I feel totally antiquated. The first one I want to talk about is tissues and deformation. And Adrian mentioned that my PhD involved looking, at least in part, at this strange little organism called Protosalvinia. And these are some SEMs. And yes, SEMs were new when I was a graduate student. We were all very excited about them. And these are SEM micrographs of this, fragments of this organism called Protosalvinia. It's an Upper Devonian thing. Nobody really knows whether it's an alga, a liverwort, or what. But one of the things that I was fascinated with was that if you look here, you can make out cellular texture. You can actually see how those cells seem to have been aligned with each other. And I've blown it up here. And those are little black pencil marks looking at the arcs of these different cells. And I said to myself, self, what can we do with these data? And the new technique that I became aware of was called finite element analysis. And finite element analysis is where you make up essentially grids with properties within each of these areas that, in my particular case, were the dimensions of these cells. You spend many nights with a microscope measuring the size and the shape of these cells. And then you mesh things up and you create, based on the information that you have, a hypothetical apical meristem. This, by the way, is a finite element simulation of what I thought the meristem looked like. And the beauty with finite elements is then you can say, grow, make this thing bigger, construct what the organism might have looked like. And I just want to go back one or a few slides and point out that you'll notice there are things here that are very different in shape. They're bilobed things and squashed things, things that look like Mickey Mouse's ears. Until I came along, those were all described as separate species. Protosalvinia ravina, Protosalvinia arnoldii, Protosalvinia furcata. And I said, well, maybe my little computer simulation will generate one of these things, and I'll be vindicated to get at least part of a mini PhD. Well, it turned out that the computer simulations told me this. All of those fragments belong to the same organism. All of them could be generated by manipulating the cell divisions in the apical meristem. And the computer simulations actually gave me an ontogeny for this fossil organism. So how do you validate this? It's just pie in the sky. You actually go and look for the intermediate stages that were never given a name, a species name. And I get my PhD because after macerating tons of material, I did manage to find intermediates. And so my PhD committee sort of said, well, yeah, this is a computer simulation. It's not really paleobotany, but okay, leave us. As Adrian also mentioned, I was doing some organic geochemistry then. I was a dilettante. I was just trying to learn stuff. And we had, at the University of Illinois, a beautiful mass spec. And so we prepared specimens, vaporized them, did all sorts of stuff. And I managed to isolate a number of compounds that are thus far only known for land plants. And so it's likely, even though this has nothing to do with modeling, it's likely that Protosalvinia lived on land. Does that make it not an alga? No, because they're not mutually exclusive. There's nothing in the definition of an alga that says you can't live on land. It's just prejudice. So we got, I got interested then in, oh no. I see what the problem is. The problem is we have a loose connection, and I'm it. I will not touch this computer again, except to start the show. So I was interested in, yes, shaky hands, because you might not know it, but I'm terribly nervous giving this talk. You're a very impressive group of people. So I started looking at tissues later on, after I actually came to Cornell, thinking about finite element analyses and how I could apply it to living plants. And I was fascinated by hollow things, including my cranium. But if you look at a variety of plants, including Equisetum, you will see that hollow stems are actually very common. Turns out, from an engineering point of view, they're perfect, because if you bend or twist something like a hollow stem, if you look at the distribution of stresses, the maximum because they're always towards the outside, and towards the inside, they're zero. So there's no reason to have stuff on the inside since it's not providing any mechanical support of any kind. And if you eliminate that biomass, you actually make the material lighter and stronger. And this is why a lot of things like bicycles and frames of airplanes are made up of hollow tubes. Well, anyway, what can we do with hollow tubes? Well, you can bend and twist them. And so I meshed up again. I love finite element analysis. And said to myself, what are the effects of these nodal septa? Periodically, the internodes are separated by a nodal septa, a little diaphragm of cells. And also, on many grasses, the base of the internode is clasped by the base of the leaf, the leaf sheath. And I wanted to know, well, what are the contributions of these things? And so we twisted and we bent and we looked at finite element simulations. And it turns out that the nodal septa provide almost 25% of the mechanical support of these structures. They act as struts that actually absorb bending and twisting energy. They absorb the strain energy. And when the applied force is removed, they act like a spring. They pop back into place. And we could actually show this using real plants and measuring with strain gauges the importance of those diaphragms. One of the secretaries here many years ago, Joan Miller, she liked to knit. And so I would get one of her long knitting needles. I'd get one of these stems, and I'd punch through all of the nodal diaphragms, measure the bending strength and the twisting strength, and we compare that to a non-surgically manipulated grass or equisetum stem. And we confirmed that 22.5% of the strength of those structures were the result of the nodal diaphragms. Another 17% is actually provided by the sheath that surrounds the base of the internodes. It acts like a girdle, and it is therefore in the proper place to absorb most of the strain energy along the internode. We also then went into a whole field of engineering called cellular solids. As botanists, you're all used to cellular solids. If you think about parenchyma, it's a cellular solid. You have a liquid phase, that's the cytoplasm, and you have a solid phase, those are the cell walls. And it turns out that cellular solids have a number of properties, biomechanical properties, that are influenced by the pressure of the fluid inside of the cellular components. Now, in engineering, styrofoams are an example of a cellular solid in which the fluid phase is a gas, okay? In botany, the fluid phase is a liquid, cytoplasm. So we did some simulations and we predicted the effect of the thickness and the radius of the cell walls in these cellular solids, and we submitted these to tests. And lo and behold, a computer model could be validated within a 5% error. So we're getting pretty happy with this kind of work, which is still being pursued in my lab, by the way. These are ongoing biomechanical questions. Aerodynamics of pollination. So now I'm switching topics. It's another example. Going back to my graduate days, I was taught these things. These are some of the oldest known seed plants. Well, these aren't, I mean, these are my watercolors. These are reconstructions of what the ovules looked like. They're Upper Devonian, Lower Mississippian. And they go by horrendous names that I had to memorize, like Salpingostoma hatsonensis. And you not only had to memorize it, you had to be able to spell it. Not anymore, because nobody really cares. Well, I was taught when I was a graduate student, here you see an ovule that looks pretty much like a modern day one. There's the micropyle, there's the integument. But if you look at some of these other little critters, this is really a megasporangium surrounded by what looks like a dead squid. And we were told as a graduate student, as graduate students, that this evolved from an ancestor that looked like that, and that the coalescence of these squid-like tentacles and their fusion towards the tip was a consequence of natural selection operating on protection from herbivores, from little mandibulated terrestrial arthropods, okay, that we'd go in there and eat the little eggs and the little megagametophyte. And I thought that was a very cute story, except I also knew that these things were wind-pollinated, or at least I was told that they were pollinated. I wasn't around in the Devonian, upper Mississippian, but not the Devonian. So I said, self, yeah, this might be protection, but what about the influence on pollen? And so I built myself a wind tunnel. Okay, so there's the contraction cone of the wind tunnel. The fan and the regulator are all here. And you might wonder what that tube is. This is the big gadget that was really important. This was a bubble generator. Now, what do I mean by a bubble generator? It used a surfactant that to create bubbles, individual bubbles, that were filled with helium. And you had a centrifugal device over here that you could actually select the size of the bubbles that you wanted. And the size of the bubbles that I wanted were bubbles that were neutrally buoyant. In other words, the weight of the little soap downward was counteracted by the lifting force of the helium. So you could actually see a bubble hover in motionless air and not move. So then you shine a big bright light on them, okay? And what you're seeing now are these little bubbles moving around a cylinder. You're looking down on the cylinder. You see the leeward side, and you see the turbulence that is generated on the downwind side. So now we had a way of visualizing airflow patterns, and we needed to photograph them, and we needed to know what they were doing from the top and the bottom to get a construct for three-dimensional airflow patterns around these structures. And here are some of the pictures. I built little scale models using clay. And there you see, in each case, the airflow is coming from the left to the right. And you see an impaction zone. These particles were just hitting the surface. But notice there was a stagnant area where turbulence was being generated. So we got a little bit excited about this. And we did a long, many series of simulations. And we looked at the airflow patterns, the statistically most dominant airflow patterns. Especially around the receptive parts of these structures to see whether or not there was a bias that might carry pollen towards the micropyle or the micropyle-like structures. Then we got really fancy and we made what we called pseudo-pollen. We could construct little things that were like pollen, only they were bigger so we could see them. And we coated the surface with sticky stuff and then we put them in a wind tunnel and we would see happily would they come near the micropyle. Well, this was interesting, but it was not all that exciting because it was not conclusive. So then I built small little models and used lycopodium spores to see what would happen. And what we found was that the structure that looks most like modern day ovules actually was the most efficient at capturing pollen around the micropylar lip. And this was just a statistical study in which we looked at the maximum pollen that were actually towards the micropyle, critical wind speeds, and we found that the structures that look like modern day ovules were the most efficient at the lowest wind speeds. So this was kind of nice, and at least it suggested that maybe the evolution of the integument might have been under two pressures from natural selection. One is protection, and one is for capturing wind pollen. Well, I got excited about this, and I thought, well, why do I have to work with dead things? I can work with living things. There are a lot of wind-pollinated things like pine and grasses. Not all grasses are wind-pollinated. I think there's one that grows in the tropics described by Bauer that's actually insect-pollinated. Can't remember the name, but I see Jerry Davis going like this rather than this, so apparently I'm okay. So we started working with pine cones, and we got a little photography, got a little bit better that we could actually look at very small scale turbulence patterns. And what we found here was that there were three things that a ovulate pine cone does. One is it produces cyclonic vortices that wrap around the orthostices and peristaches of the scale ovuliferous bract complexes. There were also little doldrums between the axis of the cone and each of these reproductive entities. And then there was backslip kind of turbulence and flow. So we got excited about this, and we pursued it. And the next big invention was a stroboscope, stroboscopic lighting. So now we broke those streamlines into fragments. And you see the successive images of my bubbles. Okay? What's nice about this is, since I know the rate at which the light is flashing, I can measure the rate of movement. Okay? So now I could not just look at patterns of airflow, I could look at distributions of local velocities, which from an aerodynamic point of view is much more impressive. Now, I just want to point out that when you're dealing with fluid mechanics, you have two ways in which you can analyze it. One is called an Eulerian approach, and the other is called the Lagrangian approach. What's an Eulerian approach? It's as if you were staring out a window and looking at everything that came by that little piece of space. Okay? That's the Eulerian approach. The other is the Lagrangian, and that is you actually follow what a particle is doing along its trajectory. And we had to do both to really get an understanding of what was going on. This is the Eulerian diagnosis of an ovulate cone. This is velocity in meters per second. And so you just look at a little bit of space, and you look at all the pollen grains or all the bubbles that are passing through that space, and you begin to quantify what its material, what its fluid mechanical behavior is. And what we found was, yes, there was inertial impaction. In other words, pollen grains would just hit the cone. But what was happening is that the airflow patterns created by the ovulate cone itself biased the sedimentation of the pollen grains on the upper surface of the ovulate bract complexes. So this was actually a very sophisticated device. In a sense, it's a turbine, but it's not rotating around its axis. It's causing the air to rotate around its axis, and it's biasing the distribution of those airflow patterns to get pollen towards where the ovules are, which are on the adaxial surface of the bract complex. Well, we didn't want to just use models, so this is a real, this is a real pine cone. This is real pine pollen. These are photographs of the worst of our experiments because, you know, there's just a cloud here. You might see little dots, but nothing conclusive. So we refined the technique using stroboscopic lighting, and just to blow this little piece up here, these now are the successive locations of a single pollen grain. You digitize this, you computerize this stuff, and again, you crank out the numbers, and you get the Lagrangian approach. So we're looking at individual pollen grains moving around a real ovulate cone. What we found out was rather surprising, because when you actually look at the number of pollen grains that are hitting the ovules of different species of pine, okay, so here are the ovulate cones. Here are the pollen grains from those ovulate cones. And what you see is the pollen that is most successful comes from the species of the cone to which it belongs. So there is selective filtration. It's a lot of noise, a lot of randomness, but wind pollination in this case is not random. It has a very deterministic component. Okay? Then we got into computer simulations, real computer simulations. These are artificial pollen grains. We were looking at what are the dimensions and densities of pollen that are the optimal for different kinds of plants. This is ephedra. These are the ovules of ephedra. Those are the little pollination droplets. We had a lot of fun. I don't have time to get into all of these stories, but I can lend you reprints. Grasses. Okay, we did the same thing with grasses. Using real pollen from the grasses, and we digitized them, and we looked at the aerodynamics around them. And what we found, we were looking here at two Let me just go back. We're looking at two different species. One is Ceteria geniculata, shown here. It has a very compact panicle. Okay, the florets, flowers are very close together, something like a pine cone in overall appearance. We also looked at this. This is a Grostis hymalis, which has a very loose panicle. You see little clusters of flowers, but on their individual stems. And the fluid mechanics around these two, dense panicle, loose panicle, very, very different, okay, as you might expect. But the other thing is we noticed that the loose panicle was a natural harmonic oscillator. Each of these little clusters of flowers on the stems of different length, different stiffness, they were oscillating in different directions and at different speeds. Whereas the Ceteria panicle was oscillating in a very predictable, natural harmonic. And we could actually measure the harmonic frequency of these things using a biaxial optical transducer that could actually track the motion of this thing in all directions. And then you could put it through a Fournier analysis and you would get the natural harmonic, the second harmonic, the third harmonic. And it turns out, let me go back, turns out that you could actually not only talk about the aerodynamics, but we now could talk about the material properties of the stems, because the natural frequency is related to the stiffness of the material, to Young's modulus. And this got us interested in solid mechanics and the interface between solid and fluid mechanics. Again, I'm just giving these as examples. I don't have time to go into all the detail, besides which they're excruciatingly boring. And they're published. Okay, so what else do you do? Well, again, as Adrian mentioned, I was an undergraduate major in mathematics. I was always fascinated by the symmetry of plants. I mean, you look at a plant and you just say, it's beautiful, but it's beautiful because in part of its symmetry. And so I got interested in phyllotaxy, the arrangements of leaves. And just to give you a few examples, Disticus example in Clivia, opposite decussate in some kind of mitt, spiral arrangement, etc. There are all these beautiful symmetries that seem to conform to what is called a Fibonacci series. Filios di Banachi, the son of Banachi, name contracted to Fibonacci, okay? But it's Filios di Banachi. Anyway, what he did is, you know, he created these wonderful mathematical kind of series. You add up the numbers, and you get the next number. Then you add up the previous number to that number, and you get the next number, the next number, the next number. And you can start with any number, but you just use this mathematical series. And if you make fractions of them, like here, and you keep increasing the numbers, they converge on the golden mean. You can convert these fractions into angles. And so the series will always approach, expressed in angles, 137.5, or thereabouts. Okay, and this excited mathematicians and botanists for hundreds of years, basically, because the golden rule now. The plants have learned the golden rule. This is why they arrange their leaves the way they do. Well, it's not true. Okay. And long time ago, we created a little mathematical model for the arrangements of leaves on a single stem. And you need only a few parameters. You need the deflection angle of the leaf. You need the rotation angle of the leaf. You need the distance between successive leaves. You need the divergence angle, that's the Fibonacci series. And then you can play around with the leaf, the length of the petiole, the width and the length of the petiole. We kept things simple. All leaves are either ellipses or circles. No lobing, nothing, just to see what would happen. And you can create all of these different phyllotactic patterns here. Now you're looking down on a kind of rosette, can put these mathematically into a computer and say, okay, the sun is going overhead from dawn to dusk. How much energy do these leaves collectively absorb? What is their efficiency at trapping light? And now you have morphospaces. What is a morphospace? Well, in this case, we have the Fibonacci angle, the divergence angle here. We have the amount of energy a plant can absorb. And by the way, this is the angle, and that's the actual fraction. So they're really the same axes. And wherever you see this big broad line here, that's the golden mean, 137.5. And you can see for little stubby rosettes, or rosettes with what look like pizza kind of shovels, or for round leaves, that really the optimal is the Fibonacci convergence series, 137.5. But the minute you start playing with internodal distances, for example, or petiole lengths, things of that sort, the difference between all of these divergence angles of leaf arrangement are washed out. One is no better than the other. Okay, so the only time that the golden mean seems to work is if you're a cabbage. If you're a rosette, where all the leaves are basically shading each other, the minute you start elongating or changing the geometry of the petiole or change the deflection angles of those leaves, it doesn't matter how you arrange it, which is really good for clivia because the leaves are in two different rows and it doesn't seem to bother it. We also could simulate the effect of latitude and things of that sort. And if you play with latitude, all of those leaf arrangements can be equally efficient. It really doesn't matter. Okay, I got two more to go, and I'm gonna go through it, I hope, in time. But this is your opportunity to leave. Okay. So early land plant evolution. Well, when I was taught paleobotany, we were all excited about the Devonian because that's when everything seemed to happen. Okay, my professors were excited, I was excited. But when you look at the plants from the Devonian, they're actually excruciatingly boring, right? I mean, really, if you were a taxonomist today, you might classify all of these things into one family or one something or another and just give them different generic and species names, binomials. But the beauty of these plants is that they're botanical tuning forks. I can mathematically describe their geometry with only a few variables, okay? I need to know, again, the bifurcation angle. What is the angle between bifurcations? What is the rotation angle? And what is the probability of branching? Other things that I can include are diameter and length of these elements. And I can create a universe of all mathematically possible structures in a fairly simple Cartesian coordinate system. This is a simple morphospace. You can go n-dimensional. You don't have to be three-dimensional, right? I mean, Descartes, there's that little thing. You have x, y, z. You know its coordinates. Can I add other dimensions? In other words, other parameters to describe the morphology? Well, of course I can. I can add more axes and forget about being three-dimensional. The other way to deal with this almost an infinite number of axes is you line them up like this, and this point and that point and that point and that point and this point and that point are all the same points. One point. That's an object in n-dimensional space. So don't let anybody tell you that you can't plot more than three dimensions. You can. It's easy. Okay? Computers can handle this. I can't. Okay? There is slices through the morphospace, okay? Just took three slices. So you get things like xylodium. You get things that look like real trees. You get things that sort of look like conifers. And then you get to things that look like a mess, okay? And years ago, I gave this talk in New Zealand, and I said, well, there's nothing really like that. And they all started laughing. And they said, you haven't seen our divaricating shrubs, have you? And I said, no. And they said, well, there are stems that grow inward, not outward. And I said, well, that's them over there. So, you know. So, okay, so now I have this morphospace. What am I going to do with it? Well, it turns out that I can quantify the performance of those morphologies in the morphospace. Okay? I can actually calculate their ability to intercept light, to conduct fluids, to reproduce, and to provide mechanical support. I've written books about how to do this. Okay, so this is my gross self-advertisement. Okay? I can give you free copies. Nobody buys them anyway. I could have made a fortune with this. It is the best cure for insomnia that I know of. I can't even read more than 3 pages and not stay awake. So yeah, just to give you an idea, you know, you move the sun over something like this and you calculate its self-shading, etc. You can look at mechanical stability. What are the moment arms, the influence of gravity? I can look at the probability of discharging spores and the distance those spores travel, etc., etc. So now, I can quantify the performance of each of those objects in the morphospace. And what I can do is I can simulate an adaptive walk. Okay? I can start someplace here, maybe the earliest known vascular land plant, and I can look around in that morphospace next to it and say, is there anything that's just as good or better? And so the computer finds that morphology. And it keeps doing this until it gets to a morphology that is surrounded by nothing that's better or as good. Okay? It's an adaptive peak. We had to test it. We had to know, does this really work? So it turns out that this is Salicornia europa. It's a little halophyte. It looks like one of these boring Devonian plants, but it's actually an angiosperm. But it had a trifurcating kind of branching pattern. And what we found was the geometry of this plant changes dramatically depending upon the density of plants, how closely they grow. So we simulated density's effect on the ability to intercept light, okay? And we compared the morphology of the plants at different plant densities to the morphology that the computer predicted, and lo and behold, we were right. Computers are wonderful things until they fail you. So we said, okay, let's look at the Devonian plants for different functions. And the first thing we tested is light interception and mechanical stability. Can you do them simultaneously? What happens? Okay. There's a conflict, by the way, because if you want to be mechanically stable, you want to be vertical. If you want to maximize light interception, you want to lie on your side. So they're opposite of each other. You have to optimize, not maximize. And so we started with Cooksonia. This is the earliest known vascular plant fossil. We found its location in the morphospace. That's what the computer says Cooksonia looks like. And now we go through the adaptive walk, and we ended with that. So just to very quickly show you what was happening is that the computer was predicting with successive events to go from something like a Rhynia-like plant with equal branching to unequal branching to overtopping to then lateral branches that started to planate and that looked something like this. And what was really curious is that that's exactly what the telome theory predicts by Zimmermann. This is how you get megaphylls. Okay? At least that's what he thought. Well, the computer said, yeah, Dr. Zimmermann, you seem to be right. The only problem with something like this is it's an opaque model. Okay? It may not be right. It's just telling you what the basis is of your assumptions. So, by the way, only 2 functions, right? Mechanics and light. What happens if you just want to maximize each performance? What happens if you put these in pairs or triplets, or what happens when you say do them all? Okay? So I'm not going to show you walks, I'm going to show you the end result. This is what happens when you have single functions. Maximizing reproduction, conservation of surface area, maximizing mechanical stability, light interception. Now, what happens when you do 2 functions? I won't read off all of these, but you'll notice things are looking a little bit more complicated. What happens if you have 3 functions? Things are getting much more complicated. What if you do all 4? Those are all equal in their performance. Okay. So many ways to make everything work. Kind of fun, because what it's saying is, if I'm a single function like a machine, I can maximize the performance, my fitness. But if I keep adding functions, the number of tasks increase, so do the number of equally efficient phenotypes, but their global fitness is down. this kind of explains why when you drive into the desert, all the desert plants don't look the same, okay? Not all trees look the same, they're equally good. Long time to talk about this, but imagine if you're an engineer and I say design a toaster. Gonna be really good. Now how about a toaster and a hairdryer? Okay, so I'm not going to go on to this. I'm going to end with this so that you can all have lunch. Last thing I want to talk about is forest dynamics. So real forests, very complicated, but it turns out that if you go into the data and you start looking at trends within sizes and girths of trees in a variety of different forests, you find very strict allometric relationships. This one is the log of standing leaf mass versus the log of standing stem mass. And you can see that's a log-log linear regression over many orders of magnitude from forests as different as conifers and mixed deciduous forests. So there are rules somehow. Question is, what are they? So Sean Hammond, one of my graduate students many years ago, had a knack for computer simulations. And I said, Sean, how about modeling forests? And he looked at me and he said, will that get me a PhD? And I said, yes. So he said, OK. So we started looking at rules. And one of them was given to us by this gentleman many hundreds of years ago. This is Apollonius of Tyana. I remember his theorems from when I took geometry, complex geometry. Yes. Well, he was a little younger then. But he was interested in how do you package things together. For example, how many circles can I get into this kind of geometry? Notice, this is the arc of a circle, that's the arc of a circle, that's the arc of a circle. And so he had some mathematics that we began to play with. And we started introducing those rules into the computer simulations. But another problem that we had was, how much do I give to make new leaves, to make new roots, and new stems? This is a banking problem. You get so much energy in a year, and you have to produce leaves, you have to produce stems, you have to produce roots. And if you produce too many leaves with respect to the stem, you can fall over. If I produce too few roots with respect to stems, I can fall over. So this is the classic allocation of biomass, not money. And we had a beautiful algorithm, starting with a little seedling, energy for growth, reproductively mature, yes, no, energy for reproduction, violate a physical law, no two objects can occupy the same space, you die. Okay, so here are the beginning of our simulations, and we were going low density and then watching them grow, higher density, higher density, higher density. And now, for all of this trauma, I want to show you a movie. But first of all, I need my glasses, because I have to press a button and I can't find it. Not to worry. There we go. Okay, so what you're looking at now is a single propagule that is reproducing. You're looking at it from this side and looking down. That's a single seed, and every iteration was 1 year, okay? So now, that was one propagule. I want to show you what happens when you randomly scatter those seeds. And this is going to go for over 600 years. Those little specks you see, those are the seeds that are being released from the canopy. Later on, you'll see some light gaps where an old tree dies, and then you'll see some little puppies filling in. See that? Oh, this is so cute. You know, you can watch it on Sunday when you're bored and it's snowing. That's almost every Sunday. But how do you test a model like this? Oh, what am I doing? Why isn't it going? Oh, wait, now, these darn computers, I don't understand why they don't do what I tell them to do. Well, let's see if we can do it this way. Okay, so how do you test a model? Well, we looked around for forestry data, and it was wonderful to find this publication from, published in Italian, University of Firenze, Italy. Imagine, they went out into a new forest and measured properties for 80 years. How many leaves? What's the girth of the stems? What's the height of the trees? Over 80 years, the School of Forestry just had new people come in, PhD students, right, go out there, measure the forest. So we had data, and what we could do is we could parameterize our computer model for this tree, Abies alba, okay? And now what I'm going to show you are graphs that look like this. One of these symbols is the data, and the other symbol is the prediction of the computer model. Nice. Nice. But there's something else that came out that we never expected. The computer model predicted how old the trees were before they would produce seeds. And that's what we found in the data set. We had cross-validation. In other words, we had an emergent property that we never put into the program, and the program made a prediction that we didn't expect but happened to be true. So, what have I learned from 45 years of modeling? It's fun. But I'm going to propose a few tools, and then I'll be done. How do you evaluate? Well, you fit empirical data, I just showed you, and you use the technique called cross-validation. You look for predictions that aren't in the algorithm that still comply with reality, okay? Like we did with the ABs. Defining a model scope, it's really important to know when a model is inapplicable. What are the range of phenomena that handle. You can interpolate, but the danger is to extrapolate. You can't go beyond the boundaries of your model unless you have data to test it. And last but not least, the appearance of emergent properties, the appearance of maturation that last model predicted. Okay? The fallacy of causality is always there. Strong positive correlations do not necessarily prove that you have cause and effect. That's always a temptation, but you have to resist it. So, questions, Peter?
I'd like to ask about a couple of parameters that I wonder if you consider with regard to light interception, because some of your plants look sort of non-physiological. So two factors. A, your leaves are not really opaque, and you mentioned that. Were you able to look at what would happen when they allow 10% through? And the other thing is the amount of light exceeds what the leaf needs. So therefore, as you tip a leaf up, you get actually more efficient for the community, which illustrates what's happened to corn. They've upped the yields like crazy by changing the leaf angle and squashing in many more plants per acre.
So no, both of those questions are really good. So to answer the first one, yes, we can. One of the parameters would be the opacity of the leaf, the transmission of photosynthetically useful radiation, because of course a lot of the light coming out of it is green, and that's not particularly exciting. Yeah, that too. The question of leaf orientation, when it comes to the canopies of trees, the best assumption is that the leaf orientation is random. Because I have a leaf like this, I have a leaf like this, I have a leaf like this, and if you have more than a few leaves, you can basically say, you can either model it as a frequency distribution, or you can just say, it's all random. Okay? And it turns out that it doesn't really matter once you get to a certain size. Because you have so many leaves, right, it doesn't have much effect. Yeah, we looked at the phenomena like that.
And
latitude. No, I never worked on corn. It's way too boring. No offense.
I have a question. I was kind of asking for some advice.
husband after him by. So, given the current state of computers and the supercomputing, what questions does the biology ask if he wants to model today or for the next 30 years?
It depends on your discipline. I mean, if I was into metabolomics, I'd be looking at metabolic systems. If I was into genetics and development, it would be gene regulatory networks. If I was into ecology, it would be community dynamics. All of those are amenable to modeling, okay? So the model is a tool, okay? The important thing about a tool is you have to have an important question. It's the question that drives the choice of tool, not the tool that drives the selection of the question. I'm kind of old school. Yeah. Randy.
You did so many successes, but I wonder if there's something that stands out in your mind that's like, well, this is it. I got it. And why?
I think that was Sean Hammond's computer modeling. We saw so many emergent properties, not just the onset of reproductivity and maturation, but a lot of other phenomena that we never expected a simple model to produce, okay? Like density-dependent death, okay? Which can be used to model the spread of pathogens. So yeah, there are a lot of applications, not just to forested communities. Chelsea?
Not so bad for just a regular science question with a big picture question, but so you've got the model of the forest community, and then you also have the model of the forms of the plants. So I have two questions about this. One is, can that be combined together so that you could actually model the forest community not just looking like a single plant, but looking like multiple species and how those would interact?
Can I answer that question first? So if you haven't heard the question, is can you use this kind of model not to look at mono-specific stands, but what happens when you have different species interacting? And in fact, we did that. We actually parameterized a number of different kinds of trees because we were looking at, we were interested in competitive exclusion. Do one of these things muscle out the other? In very few cases, we found that coexistence was the rule. What would happen, however, if you started with equal numbers of seeds that were randomly distributed, you would see that some species would be repressed. So their numbers would drop below 25% if you had four, but then they would plateau and they would persist for as long as we ran the simulations. And that's something that Sean is actually following up on now that he's got a tenure track position. So you had another question.
So was that related to your other model where you were predicting the forms? So right. If you use sort of a history and said, okay, these are the potential forms that could be there, they're restricted in their history and their branching patterns and what they're going to look like, can you use those two models to kind of inform each other?
Yes, you can. So the question is, can you use the two last models that I talked about where you had different forms, can you use them to fertilize one another? You can, okay, but when you start modeling something like that, you have to make a large number of assumptions, and the results will be very dependent on assumptions. Again, the early evolution land plant model is an opaque model, okay? It may not tell us anything about reality, but what it does do is it makes the logical consequences of our assumptions transparent. I will tell you that those simulations were done on Atari simulators, Atari computers. We had four Atari computers hooked up as a network. And some of those simulations took months. And this goes a lot of brownouts. You would lose the results of those simulations. So it was not easy. Now we've got big computers. Okay. What took us months maybe take a few hours. I mean, those the modeling that I did with finite elements with Proto-Salvinia, that was using Fortran. Fortran, you know, stacks and stacks of what looked like postcards, the little holes punched in. You drop it and you were scarred all over again. Is that it? Thank you for coming. Have a lovely day.
This has been a production of Cornell University on the web at cornell.edu.